name is Kimmel. I'm an after-school site manager. I'm also a writer, a playwright, and an actor. My grandfather didn't want us playing with the alley kids or the projects. It was a stigma. It was a class war. My grandfather thought he was better than. His whole thing was, I don't want you playing with them kids. If you play with them, you're gonna get in trouble. Stay away from them kids, they're bad. I don't want them to make you bad.
It's funny because the projects is across the street from this house. So he would come out on this porch and he would get dressed up with his pleated pants and his Florsheim shoes, and he wanted white people to ride down this street and see that he had something. Unfortunately, when my mother and father got divorced, we ended up living in the projects and nobody deprogrammed me, so I thought that because I was a product of the projects that I was just as messed up and undesirable or all the stuff that he planted in my head. I never was told otherwise. Yeah. As I grew up, I thought because I lived in the projects, I was never going to be anything.
My mother and father got into an argument and my father threw my mother down a flight of steps. And he broke her back.
Okay. She decided to leave him, and she took her three children, and we made a home.
We drove to Elmore Square. It was winter time, December, January, February, one of those cold months. Opened the door. The house was warm, smelled like fresh paint. It was that ugly green project paint, but it was pretty to me. And it smelled like food, and this was our new home. It wasn't as bad as my grandfather had said it was supposed to be. My mother put baby powder in the sheets, so when we got into bed, it smelled fresh. She made that experience happy, and that sticks in my mind.
There was a break-in. To my knowledge, my mother was raped, and I can remember my mother screaming. He grabbed my mother by her throat and pulled her to the door and said, tell those kids to shut up. And she said, Mommy's okay, be quiet. And we were quiet.
Some children that live in traumatic situations, they survive by suppressing negative thoughts. And I truly believe I'm one of those people.
I understand what my grandfather was talking about right now. He wanted to keep us safe. And this square kept us safe. Don't go off the porch. Don't play with the project kids. I guess.
I was experiencing this sadness, but people always seen me happy. I mean, I used to go to college and I wrapped my hair in turbans and I would wear African jewelry and you are kings and queens and so forth. But it was a fake to the point that my mother bought me a book when I was in college. If I feel so successful, why do I feel like a fake? Now, why she bought me that book to this day, I don't know, but she must have sensed that I didn't believe the things that I was projecting or saying. Subconsciously, I did not think that I was pretty. I always thought my lips were too big. Even if a man in my adult life said, you have beautiful lips, I would say, don't say that. It would make me cringe. People would say, look at those big-lipped Africans. You know, you see the Aunt Jemima lips and the Juju lips, and the lips were so big. And so anytime I seen any image of that, it looked like me. The big lips, the googly eyes, the dark skin, the, ooh, I'm Aunt Jemima. So that perception of growing up like that subconsciously changed who I became as a young adult. It manifested itself in my choice of men. I just chose the wrong people. I didn't think that I was worthy of dealing with someone better. I was probably looking for a father figure.
How am I doing, man? Like, I'm chilling with this Miss Lady right here. Oh, you know what I mean?
Up,
we just doing that, and I'm about to smoke my black.
Pittsburgh,
baby. 412, do what you do.
My father's voice was like Lou Rawls, and I noticed that the men that I dealt with had this deep, rich, resonating voice. I didn't care what you look like, I didn't care whether you had a house, a car, money in the bank. Even if they had red flags, straight up, you're a red flag dude. Your deep voice, hey baby, what's up? Was like, I'm missing my daddy. So I just fell into, you got a big butt, I like you. You're my man now, let's do this. Yeah, I mean, it's not cool, but it's funny how when you look back on things, that's some of the things that occur.
So, red dye number 22.
Sometimes if you don't know what somebody does, you have a tendency to be afraid. Don't be afraid. I'm a professional. I'm not going to make you look like a prostitute or a showgirl or a monkey or a chimpanzee, anything like that. My job is to enhance what you have. So all of you are very beautiful young girls.
I work with young girls that have low self-esteem. A little girl told me, Miss Kim, I'm real dark-skinned. I look like dirt. So this is this cycle. And she's a very jet black, beautiful little girl, but she wanted to know where she can get bleaching cream. Why are little girls saying that? You know? Why did I say it?
He's sniffing that fingerhole. You need to calm down.
And so it profoundly affects it, meaning society, media, magazines, movies, words affect us little girls.
Hello, you're looking at me, the audience. Listen, you cannot get up like a bunch of scattering roaches.
If I know a man and he has a daughter, I said, please sit down and show your daughter how she's supposed to be treated as a female, because I never ever learned that.
We have to do whatever we have to do to save our children.
It led me to domestic violence in relationships.
This is a daily reminder to love yourself, not to hurt yourself.
It led me to dealing with an unwanted pregnancy. I made a choice to have my baby, but I was hooked up with a man that was not a provider.
I've never seen a dog.
Why did we stay together for 10 years? Because my father did not stay with my mother. Because I want my daughter to know her father. It was not a wise decision. It led me to feeling more depressed because life in the real world is not the way I thought it would be. I was told that if you did right and did all the good things would occur to you. I graduated from Duquesne University, and I was 6 months pregnant. So that's what it did.
I graduated from college, moved back into the projects, didn't have a job, and had to go on welfare. It was a scary cycle. I had to ask for food stamps. And getting the food stamps, when I went to get the food in the grocery store, I couldn't make a decision, and it just made me cry. I couldn't stop crying. And I eventually felt that I needed to get some help. And I started looking back on where it all started, and I think it started with the concept of that I was less than most people are because I lived in a projects. Ain't that some shit? Sorry. But that's it. That's the truth.
I would say that at least half of my life I spent in a state of depression. To feel sad for a day or two can be normal. To be sad for a year or two is not cool. I'm a work in progress, and my first step was to know that it's okay to live in the projects. My first step is to say that it's okay to be brown-skinned with a pudgy nose and thick lips and curly hair. And as I acknowledge that, that's just one step to being better. I feel loved, but at this point right now, I think I need to love myself more so that my daughter can see that I love myself so that she can love herself, because it is a cycle. You know, it's a cycle, and sometimes I don't think she loves herself as much as she could. And so even if it has to be an act, I have to act like I love myself.